Good evening, everybody. My name is John Gormley from Men's Human Rights Ireland. My co-host tonight is Paul Carr. And tonight we have Janet Bloomfield, we have Kristal Garcia, Jessica Kenny, Karen Straughan, Hannah Wallen, Ruth Patterson, and we have a couple of other guests coming on very shortly, Rachel Edwards, and hopefully very soon, Anne O'Regan. Hi, Rachel. Hi, we're live at the moment. Tonight we're talking about a very subject which has been in the newspapers and media all over the place, which is women against feminism. Hello, Anne. We're live at the moment. Hi, we're live at the moment. Can I ask basically why was any of you went along and started off to be against feminism? Janet?
First of all, thank you for having me here, and thanks for having this discussion. I think it's a really important one. I think I started off being against feminism right back in university when I was studying feminism, and I could see that most of what we were studying, most of the claims that my professors were making amounted to nothing more than whining and didn't match up to what I could see in real life. And to me, there was no question that this was simply a matter of being bitter and hateful towards men. And I had three brothers, so my lived experience with men didn't match what I was being taught by feminists at all.
Rachel?
Oh, hi. Well, I really don't agree. I don't really believe in a lot of that ideology. It really has become this cult of victimhood. And I really did want to help women. I really did believe in equality. And then I found that all of this stuff that they were saying, I mean, it really is like Janet said, I really didn't feel like it matched up to real life. It's gotten to the point where they're so detached from reality and living like a... Every little sin or mini aggression that you do hurts everyone, hurts all women, and it's just, it's disgusting.
Karen, would you like to say something?
Just to clarify, I can use cuss words on this show, right?
If you keep them to a bare minimum, yes.
Okay. Okay. I just want to make sure that I don't have to like really watch my language. Basically, I started out with this sort of ambivalent attitude toward feminism. I knew it was basically a load of hooey, just because it didn't mesh with what I was seeing day to day at any point in my life, even when I was a little kid. But when I stumbled across some websites that actually went into statistics on domestic violence and the research on its causes and that women are just as likely, if not more likely, to perpetrate as men, that, you know, then you're comparing it with these sort of feminist internet clearinghouses, information sources on domestic violence that say 85% of the victims are women or 90% or it's a male on female problem. And then, you know, I'm looking into it and I'm seeing that we're basing government policy on this false narrative that, I mean, and it's not like they have an excuse. That the evidence has been there since, I think, 1974 was the first study published that showed women commit domestic violence as much as men do, right? So, and then since then, there have been hundreds and hundreds of studies done across cultures, finding even in patriarchal societies, very patriarchal societies like Jordan or Namibia, you still have that gender symmetry. And they're still applying this completely false paradigm to it and basing public policy, and judges get trained based on this paradigm, and, you know, guardians ad litem get their training. You know, it just, that's when I became anti-feminist. That's when I became a woman against feminism, was when I saw how they've been lying to everybody. So, yeah.
Cool. You were talking to us before about domestic abuse in Wales. Can you give us some indication, your own views toward feminism? Sorry, Anne, forgive me.
Yeah, hi. Yeah, I think I first started getting opposed to feminism when I was an equalities officer with a trade union. And I looked at gender equality pages on like the Trade Union Congress and other trade unions, and it's all about women's issues. And I'm thinking, whoa, this can't be right. But when I really started getting passionate about it is when Wales were going to introduce an End in Violence Against Women bill. I went to public consultations. I was a lone voice there because I really looked into it a lot and read the Task and Finish Group report. There was a particular paragraph in this report that stated masculinity is associated with violence in most cultures, and Wales is no exception. Well, that really peed me off. I thought, are they talking about my dad, my husband, the men I love? And then when I looked at statistics and provisions for male victims of domestic abuse, then I was absolutely, totally on the case and hope to do an awful lot more.
Can I ask Gerald Wright's what a question? She said that there's international studies show gender parity in Jordan, Namibia. What study in particular are you talking about there?
There was actually one. Marie Strauss wrote about it. He's a leading domestic violence researcher. He basically heard that the UN was doing a massive cross-cultural study on partner violence and dating violence. And the preliminary results came in for the first four countries, including Jordan and Namibia, that found that among young people under 21, the women, both the boys and the girls agreed that the girls were more likely to perpetrate violence. I mean, it was just, they asked the same questions, who is perpetrating dating violence? And both the boys and the girls said it was mostly girls. Now, he was really interested because of the fact that those two of those countries were developing countries, and they were countries that are, you know, supposedly have this huge patriarchal culture where all of these, like Anna said, where masculinity is associated with violence, particularly violence against women. So he was really, Marie Strauss was really interested in getting the full report. And what he found was when they published the full report that included all 35 countries or whatever, they had removed the questions asking about female perpetration and male victimization. They had removed those two questions. So they'd completely erased that half of the results from their full United Nations report. And this is something that he has seen over and over and over and over again, is that either those questions are not asked in the first place, they're asked, but the answers are ignored or otherwise minimized, or set aside, or that feminists who cite studies that find gender symmetry only cite the data in those studies that pertains to female victimization and male perpetration, right? So, I mean, really there is, and I don't even think you need to be a conspiracy theorist to understand that, you know, or to consider that this is happening. You just need to consider human nature and how one of our biggest priorities is protecting women, right? Mm-hmm. So, especially protecting women from men. So, and what this has always been a cultural value.
What particular UN agency was it? The World Health Organization that basically stripped out the?
I don't recall. I could send you the link to Dr. Strauss's account of that. I believe it probably would have been the World Health Organization or some similar body within the UN that was conducting that study, for sure.
Yeah, it's very interesting. I read an article in A Voice for Men about Iran, which, you know, we like to think is a country that oppresses women in a certain narrative in the West, but in fact it's actually just like the West. It's another misandric society where women get a very good deal, you know, in marriage and divorce, and they're well looked after, just like in Western countries. It really really opened my mind.
This is one thing I constantly do, because there's so many MRAs and anti-feminists who will say things like, why don't you go to Saudi Arabia or Iran and do some work there where women are actually oppressed? And I mean, women aren't necessarily treated wonderfully in those cultures. Men are not treated wonderfully in those cultures. Women are not oppressed relative to men in those cultures. If they're oppressive, they're oppressive to everybody. So
that's something I've noticed myself with the likes of when they talk about stonings of women in third world countries. I mean, for every single stoning of one woman, it's about 20 men get stoned to death or get burned to death. I'd like to bring Kristal into this. Kristal, you were on the streets of Manhattan in New York, and you were talking to men. Talking to women about how they feel about men. How do women feel about men?
Well, I was going around asking women if they would take a photo supporting men's human rights, and most of them had never heard of the movement. One of them specifically said, well, why aren't men doing this? And I'm like, well, they are. But you see, when men do this, they're either called misogynists or they're not heard. And then one of the women said, the same woman, I was walking away, and she's like, well, this is terrible that this has to exist. And I asked her to clarify. I was like, what do you mean? And she's like, well, it's terrible that feminism has existed to the point, you know, that what feminism has done, that the men's human rights movement is needed, is what she was saying. So there were a lot of women who were pretty, you know, once they started to hear what I was saying, were pretty upset to hear what was happening, what was being kept from men and stuff like that. So, you know, I had one person where I spoke to who was a feminist, but she hadn't heard of the movement at the time. But I gave her the information. She was going to read it, whatever. But most of the women I spoke to were very supportive. And as you can see, well, you can't see it, but I got a lot of pictures of women who did want to show their support and want to learn more. So it's not something, you know, the men's human rights movement, most people here don't know about it. So the more people hear about it, the more people who get information, people do want to hear about it.
We've been getting an awful lot of emails from people who basically didn't know that there was somebody out there who is actually trying to help and change things. So about a few months ago, basically me and my fellow admin were on the streets of Dunleary, and we were talking to women down there. Basically, we were giving out flowers and talking to women and telling them what it was we were doing and why we were doing it. Most people have actually, most women seem to know that there's something very serious wrong with our society. It's men who don't seem to know. I don't know why that is. Ruth, do you know why that is?
Well, hello, everyone.
How you doing?
Thank you so much for having me on the show this evening. I am in awe of all of you. This is my first time being involved in this. And given that I am a political representative representing one of the poorer areas within the South Belfast area, I had certainly noticed that some of our young men and boys were very, very disenfranchised. And I think 40 years of conflict certainly hasn't done our young men and boys any favours. There's poor role models out there. We see that young boys and young men, rather than staying at school, studying, getting an education, getting qualifications, getting out there and building a life for themselves and looking towards their future, they are actually looking at role models who aren't good role models, people who have gone out and done things that they shouldn't have done, and who rule communities, sadly, with a rod of iron. And this is what these young men have to look up to. And I certainly am doing my utmost to change that within those poorer areas. And it is coming. It may be slow, but it is coming. And certainly I want to see young men coming very much to the fore. I believe greatly in equality for everybody, regardless of your race, your religion, your class, or your creed. Equality is something that everyone deserves in life and that everyone needs. Certainly, I'm very new to this. I have been sucked into this by a very good friend of mine.
He's a good guy.
He's a good guy. Yeah.
We are talking about.
Great guy.
And I recently put down on the 1st of July in council a motion regarding having the first ever International Men's Day, not only in Belfast, but throughout Northern Ireland. And hopefully we will have a very positive response to that from Council, with funding hopefully coming to the fore. And no doubt it would be great if you guys could come along, enjoy the day. And possibly
we will be delighted to. We're looking very, very much looking forward to it. Jessica, up there in the corner, how's things with you?
Excellent. Jessica? Sorry, double-tasking here.
I believe you were making a sandwich for your boy there.
Yes, he's enjoying his peanut butter and jelly.
Excellent. So why was you got involved with anti-feminism?
I don't know, I don't feel like my story's really that interesting. I was always kind of, I was always non-feminist. I was never, prior to this whole thing, outright anti-feminist. I was pretty non-feminist for a while. I was very girl power, but I always thought that, feminism was just these girls complaining about not being equal. Why don't they just go out and prove it and do the things that you're saying that everybody says you can't do? And it always just bothered me. So at one point, a little over a year ago, I was kind of curious to define my position, I guess, to define how I felt about everything. And I thought of anti-feminism, actually opposing feminism. And so I got looking online, looking into some videos, found Christy O'Misty, which was really interesting, had some really interesting videos that rang true with me. A lot of things that she said just made a lot of sense. And then, of course, her videos led to the fantastic Karen Strong that we're chatting with today, and learned a whole lot more there. And a lot of things just started to make sense. Things that I had been noticing for a while. I'd always had great men in my life, a fantastic father, a wonderful brother, now a fantastic husband. And I couldn't understand why it was so normal for, like in the media, the things that we're used to, the bumbling father stereotype, these images in the media of men that are just really demeaning. And, I'd think about it and say, if we did the opposite, if we portrayed women this way, everybody would be up in arms. Everybody would be so upset. So why is it okay that we can portray men like this? And nobody really says anything until I started looking a little further, and I found that people were saying something. And the other things that they had to say about, what was going on in society made a lot of sense and rang true with me. So here I am today.
Rachel?
Hey there.
Hiya, how you doing?
Hi.
Why was you joined the, I can't remember if I asked you or not before, why was you joined the anti-feminist movement?
Well, like I said, I don't really agree with the cult of victimhood attached to it. I don't believe in things like, patriarchy theory. It's it's just, I started out, really, really wanting to get involved, and I really did believe in equality, and I saw all these different double standards for men and women, even within, the feminist movement. I remember trying to talk to them about these obvious things that I knew to be true, which that, boys and men were also victimized, but they sort of sweeped it under the rug and they didn't want to talk about it. And I really got frustrated with it. I'm like, well, why is this so difficult to talk about? Why do you think that it's okay to have these double standards? And it's just so ridiculous. It's frustrating to try and talk to these people. And they'll ask, you being a non-feminist is hurting everybody. You're hurting everything that these women have worked so hard to work. I'm like, how is that happening? How is me telling women to go out of their way and, be capable, be strong, take charge of your own life and not need a sisterhood? How is that hurting people? How are you helping? And, about that point, I just started, doing research and things like that and started watching Karen's videos. And I got involved with the Honey Badgers and I haven't looked back.
Oh. I was watching all these on the International Men's Human Rights Conference in Detroit. I have to say, I was blown away by all of you. Karen, what were your initial impressions of the whole thing and the media afterwards, what people were saying in media about that conference? I know there was no... there wasn't any misogyny. I think Dr. Tara made reference to it. She was the third woman speaker in that conference. It seems a bit strange that people would go along and say that it was a bunch of misogynists when the third speaker was, the first three speakers were women.
Yeah. Well, okay. I can understand how having several women speakers and prioritizing them by putting them first on the roster isn't necessarily proof that there's no misogyny there.
Yeah, but they mean they were brilliant, though.
They absolutely were. Aaron, I spent a lot of the weekend with Aaron Pizzi and Ann Cools, Senator Cools, and they are just the most awesome ladies, and just absolutely fantastic and wonderful. Senator Cools is just, she's got this gorgeous way of speaking imperiously. If I could... I'll have to practice for 20 years before I can actually pull it off speaking that imperiously as she does. But the conference itself was awesome. It was so, like, it was warm, it was welcoming. You know, here I am in, you know, a space with where I suppose women were probably about 20 to 30% of, maybe less, of the attendees. And I felt safe the entire time. I felt safer there than I feel sometimes, you know, at work or, you know, like just with people who I know are all well-meaning and who all want to, you know, wish me well and who all are just there to as a support system, right? It was incredible. It was incredible to be able to talk to so many people who I only knew through internet comments and just to, you know, and meet them face to face and get a feel for who they are in real life and all of those things. And the speakers were amazing. I think Robert Franklin was probably one of the least famous people or least well-known people speaking, but he was absolutely amazing talking about the foster care system and child protection services and all of those things, right? It was just a really, really wonderful, warm experience for me and a lot of fun. And then to read some of the articles in the mainstream about it, it was just like, were they there? You know, and I suppose maybe it felt hostile to them because the entire set of ideas that were presented at that conference, that men are human beings, that men are discriminated against, that this is wrong, that we need to do something about it, that feminism is not some angelic sisterhood of benevolent women bestowing gifts on everybody, that it's actually not that at all. That, you know, like, so the ideas felt hostile to these people, and I think that it tainted their entire experience, just sort of in a us versus them kind of way. They felt like they were in hostile territory, even though I'm sure they were treated with respect and all of the things that they would, you know, I don't think that there was only one guy, one male journalist who was hit on by a guy who seemed to see one of the attendees who seemed to see it as an opportunity to, I guess, score, right? Who was escorted out after he pestered a number of the men there, and they complained to the security people, and this gentleman was escorted out. This is not a dating venue. You know, get lost, right? But you know, this male reporter made a big deal out of that, which I found, and then he says something along the lines of, now I know what it's like to be treated, you know, the way women are treated every day of their lives. And I was reading that, and I was going, I called bullshit.
I got to say one thing here on that. He made a big deal about it in his news article, but while he was at the event and he had access to security, he didn't say anything to anybody. Not one word. So if he was so upset, he certainly didn't do anything to prevent it from happening to anybody else.
Sure. I think Karen's being way too generous in suggesting that they had their ideas challenged. They didn't have their ideas challenged. They came in there with an agenda. They had zero intention of learning anything. And that's the kind of hostility that we face in mainstream media. And I don't think we're just going to have to keep shoving. They come in with an agenda. They've no intention of listening to us. And they're basically whiny babies who can't stand the fact that they're losing control of this narrative. But guess what? They are.
And they're listening. Yeah. What they're doing is they're selectively listening too, right? Like you can have 15 minutes of completely unobjectionable, fair-minded rhetoric. And then one of the speakers says one thing that could possibly be taken the wrong way if it's isolated from the entire context. Right?
Oh, but they sure don't like us cherry picking Jessica Valente, do they?
Oh, well.
Yeah.
But Jessica's one of the sisterhood.
Oh, right.
Oh, yeah.
It's different.
Right.
Yeah.
We've actually been trying to get some media to talk to us, and it's next to impossible. They just will not speak to us. What tactics have the feminists used to shame and bully women and men into silence? I mean, we touched on this moment ago with the media end of things, but I mean, what kind of things have they done? I mean, I know like every time they have a chance to, they will say to me and other MRAs that we hate women. I don't hate women. I love women. And some of my best friends are women. And my wife's a woman. My mother's a woman. Why would I hate women? I mean, it's preposterous. I mean, what kind of things have they done to all of you to try to silence you?
Oh gosh, some of them have actually been outright threatened. I have personally been threatened with, we are going to call Child Protective Services and have your children taken away from you if you don't shut up.
Wow.
Well, obviously, if you're anti-feminist, Hannah, you're a bad mother too, right?
Yeah.
I mean, like, I know...
Well, and
I know
I'm raising a boy.
I know that I've been called crazy. I've been accused of having Stockholm Syndrome. I've been accused of being a battered woman. I've been accused of being an attention whore, a literal whore. I've been accused of being just jealous of the prettier girls. I've been accused of... I have been accused by one of the most radical feminists on YouTube, who is probably one of the most objectionable people I've ever had the pleasure of interacting with. I've been accused of creating a false narrative of victimhood in men so that I can cash in on their pity party by convincing them to send me money so I can help solve problems that don't really exist. So she actually has accused me of victimizing men, right?
Yeah.
And all those poor men.
This is from a member of a billion-dollar industry.
I know. I am so
multi-billion
rich right now. I'm having my bathroom taps gold-plated ASAP as soon as I actually can afford to have an upstairs toilet. I will have those taps gold-plated.
So, oh, yeah, I'm going to have a gold-plated bathroom tap.
Karen, as soon as you have a chance to, please, Karen, as soon as you have a chance to, can you please go and send me your PayPal details? I'll send the money through right now.
Oh yeah, it better be six figures, or you're useless to me. you know, honestly, it's ridiculous to even imagine that there is any significant amount of money floating around in this movement. Most of the men who come to the movement, I would guess at least half of them are, they've been through the meat grinder of family court, and they are paying 40 to 60% of their income in alimony and child support. And, you know, Terrence Pop, one of the speakers at the conference, lived in his car for quite a while. You know, these are not men with a lot of money. And yeah, so, you know, you have to do this for the passion of it. You have to do it for your principles. You can't expect to make a living doing this.
No.
Feminism, on the other hand, makes, well, literally makes billions of dollars. And a lot of it is kind of hidden because instead of, you know, it's not like you have this PayPal account that says feminism on it and they get donations from, you know, no, they have all these minute little industries, you know, sub industries, cottage industries, people who advise universities about how to teach students the latest, greatest, next best definition of consent, you know, where you both have to hop on one foot while screaming loudly, I do, you know, or some other such stupid thing. And it's going to get that ridiculous, I'm telling you.
Bring your pom-poms, yeah, ladies.
Bring your pom-poms, yeah. And, yeah, and they have all these different ways that you can capitalize on just essentially the idea that a human problem only exists when it's happening to women and girls, and only relief is only deserved if it's for women and girls. And it's, they're making huge sums of money based on this. That's, you know, what do you make if you run a DV shelter, a domestic violence shelter? What do you make if you run a hotline for women? And so on. And that's kind of what took me from being a rejecter of feminism to being an activist against feminism. When I started realizing this is a widespread worldwide problem where feminist organizations, feminist groups, and individual feminist women are exploiting and capitalizing on this narrative, this victim narrative that they can use to demonize men and make women appear helpless in order to agitate for more money and more power.
I think they're grossly underestimating how the media works, though. I mean, the media doesn't really have any skin in the game. They don't care one way or another. They're delivering words to advertisers. And if we can get out there, if we could penetrate just enough to start to show the media that we have more support than they do, we generate more clicks than they do, it will flip overnight. It's going to stun them how quickly it will flip.
I think it kind of depends on which media you're working with, because
all of them, they're all like, profit.
If you go to journalism school in the United States, you get indoctrinated with political left-wing liberalism. Like the Democrat Party type political, the social justice warrior type political left-wing liberalism. And the graduates that come out of those programs, especially like bachelor's degree graduates come out of those programs, and they're in their early 20s, they're idealistic, they have no idea how things actually work between people in the real world because they've been encapsulated their whole lives in school. And so it's going to take a pretty big, pretty hard hit to flip that media, because they may not have a stake in the game, but they do have a set of political beliefs, and they do operate on those political beliefs. And that's something that we can't go forward without addressing.
That was one of these I was going to say to you. How do we get more people involved in the men's rights movement and to see exactly what it is that feminism is? What steps should we go along and take to actually say, to flip people and say, well, hold on a second, that's not right. That's only half the story. Men suffer as well. I think
street activism.
I think naked protests would be good.
Naked protests.
I've pondered over this really, really a great deal, and I think the best thing that I think will be most helpful will be if people focus on things that they can do right now. Just things that are very small, achievable goals. If you look at it as this huge, impossible feat, it's going to feel that way, and you're going to be devoured by that sense of despair. You have to focus on these little achievable things, like, can you talk to people that you know? Can you, you know, deliver these facts to people? It just little things that you can do. You may not be able to open a men's center in your area or things like that, but what you can do is what you can. I mean, you know, just make small goals and follow through. And that's the best thing that can happen.
Right, and that is actually really good. And in order for that to happen with people, relationships is the big key. Like, if you come with two people and be like, this is what you need to do, it's not going to really work. But if you start you know, with you, your friendships and relationships, you slowly kind of drip it in here and there. If you're patient, over time, you start giving some of this information. Eventually, people start to get it. Not everybody can take it all at once. And also, street activism is really important. And there's different types of activism. Like, the way I see it, there's collision activism, and there's rejuvenating activism, which to me, that means collision is you're getting people head on, you're getting into debates, you're, you know, getting out there, you're doing a lot of things where you are getting people head on. And that's going to kind of look sometimes a little bit more intense. And there's also what I call rejuvenating activism, which is not, you don't go out to rejuvenate someone else, you don't have that power, but something that sustains you as an activist, where maybe you can either balance the two, which is kind of what I need to do so I don't burn out so fast. Or for some people, there's, you know, they prefer just collision or they prefer just rejuvenation, but also don't stand against each other as activists. Both of those types are necessary. You need collision activism and you need, you know, the more gentler activism. Both are necessary to move forward. So support each other as activists too. When you fight against each other, it kind of doesn't help the movement when you're too busy fighting against each other. The whole point is not to be right, I'm right, you're wrong, but to stay focused on the whole reason we're here. We're here for the men and boys, and we're here to support the human rights of men and boys. If we start getting into pissing contests, that's not going to help the movement.
That's absolutely spot on. I really, you know, because I really think we all really need to link together as one. You know, the women's movement have stuck together. The victim word is the one they use all the time. And I'm absolutely peed off being called a victim. I've never been a victim. And I think most of the ladies speaking here never have. You know, they talk about glass ceilings, about barriers for everything. And it's all wrong. You know, I mean... But one of the ways I think we could really engage an awful lot more activists is through the trade union movement. Do you know the trade union movement is not being touched by this? Every campaign that I've ever been part of is all about women and women's issues. I mean, recently we've had 12 men that have won an equal pay claim in Wales, which is wonderful stuff. You know, there's lots, but. The trade unions are not picking up and running with any of the men's issues. And I really think if we could get into the trade union movement, we could gain a lot more activists.
Sorry, I'm just writing a note here. We lost Ruth there a moment. Ruth, you're back again. Ruth?
Ruth Patterson. Ruth.
Okay, well, while Ruth is coming in.
Yes, I am indeed. Thank you so much.
Oh, she got it. Okay, great.
Ruth, please. Ruth, off you.
Hi.
Ruth, can I just say that your speech was really inspiring at the Belfast City Council.
There are some come out there that have really hit home with me. And principled. And certainly whenever feminists are attacking the girls across the water with their threatening and their bullying and their slandering, it really says a lot more about them than it does the girls who are trying to work for men's rights. Certainly here in Northern Ireland, our First Minister, the Right Honourable Peter Robinson, was astounded that Northern Ireland didn't have a men's shelter. And yeah. I think that is what has spurred him on to become very much a part of International Men's Day. And I really look forward to him taking part in that. We really want to move this forward. I myself came out of a violent marriage, a violent relationship. But I certainly didn't become a victim because of it. I became a very strong, independent woman who moved forward with my life, who raised 4 children on her own, who now has 6 beautiful grandchildren. And, you know, my sons are strong, independent young men who love women. My daughters love men. I love men. And, you know, you're only a victim if you want to become a victim. It's how you choose to move forward with the situation that you're in. And you can really improve your life by moving forward positively.
Well said, Ruth. Kristal, you were saying about how to move things forward. The one way I think in my mind is for every mother to look at her son and think, well, he does not deserve to see this kind of stuff that's on the media, which is on a constant basis, which demeans all men and boys. I've seen some truly dreadful stuff on the TV on a constant basis, which really is really, really awful. Does anyone have any thoughts on how best to change that, maybe to go along and contact advertisers and say, listen, this is insulting to boys and men, to my son, to my father, my brother, my lover, my husband. This is demeaning. I'm not buying your products.
Well, you know, like that really is what people have to do. They have to vote with their wallet and they have to let advertisers and companies know that this is why I'm not going to buy your product. But, you know, one of the things that they really, that I think activists and advocates really need to do is they need to highlight the damage to boys, because we are not at a point yet where anybody in the mainstream is really going to give a shit how, you know, this piece of advertising that's based on this negative stereotype of men is going to hurt or offend or upset a grown man, right?
But, it's all considered to be tongue-in-cheek.
It is. Well, and men are tough enough to take it. They're tough enough to take a joke, right? And
but boys not.
Yeah, boys are another thing. And, you know, when I look at, say, something like the boys are stupid, throw rocks at them thing, and what message that sends to boys, and it would be completely different if we still allowed... because I think actually boys are stupid, throw rocks at them is borrowed from Little Rascals, those little short black and white movies that they used to, you know, like ages and ages ago. And the phrase was girls are stupid, throw rocks at them. Right. And if we allowed some balance of, you know, negative and positive images for girls and negative and positive images for boys in the media. Right. Because we all should be able to have a sense of humor about ourselves and about different, you know, stereotypes and all of those things, right? I don't think having a sense of humor about, you know, the bumbling dad thing is such a bad thing. But right now, that message about bumbling dad, that's the overwhelming message in our media. It's not countered by any kind of positive message to any extent. And I think it was Paul Nathanson who did a talk in Toronto at the University of Toronto last year. He said that someone had shown him their data on depictions of men and women in advertising, and they had come to the conclusion that 100% of if there was any situation in which a man and a woman were in some kind of competition. Right. And the competition could be something as insignificant as, are you getting all the milk products you need in a day? And you can actually look at the milk ads and say, are you getting enough milk? And the mother and the teenage daughter get the check mark, and the husband and the teenage son get the X's. They're not getting enough milk. Right. This sociologist said, you know, I have looked at this and looked at this, and in every single case where a woman and a man are in competition with each other, the woman is portrayed as coming out on top, and the man is portrayed as losing. And Paul Nathanson said, you know, this can't be right, because in sociology, nothing is ever 100%. So he said he and his partner watched every advertisement closely that they saw on TV for 10 years, and they only came across one advertisement that actually showed a man get the upper hand on the woman in the scenario, right? And yeah, all of the rest went the other way. This is not a series of messages that we should be subjecting, you know, our 4- and 5- and 6-year-old boys to. It's ridiculous, you know, like, and then they wonder, why are these boys just not measuring up? Why are they failing? Why are they dropping out of school? Well, maybe because they're living down to your expectations of them, right? And that's the really sad thing.
if they're airing those commercials during the Olympics, it has the nice double effect of showing how feminism and the idea that women always have the upper hand is a total and utter joke. I mean, if we're really interested in equality, why do we have men in women's events? If women are as good as men, why don't you pole vault with the boys?
Yeah,
absolutely.
That actually kind of leads me to something I saw today earlier. There's an image going around on a couple of different social media, or actually a series of images, and it says something like 55 ways women change the world. And then it goes through, and there's 55 pictures there, and they're great pictures of historical things that, you know, they're not specifically remarkable in that people did them. The main thing that makes these things remarkable really is only that women did things that were hard that are generally expected of men. And it was things like women in military, women firefighters, women doing things, being the first woman to do something that a man had already done. Mm-hmm. And it was presented on, I think on Facebook, in my feed, by one of my Facebook friends as a sort of an evidence
girl
of physical
power.
Equality, girl yeah, power, yeah. and all this. Yeah. And the first
girl
thing I thought was, yeah, if it's extraordinary if just being a woman makes it extraordinary for you to do something that it's not considered extraordinary when a man does it, it's not equality. It's a clear demonstration that we're not physically equal, and that we're not performing equally, and that our achievements are not equal.
It's called just trying to catch up.
Yeah. It's catching up. And it's exactly the kind of attitude that feminists claim to want to eschew. And yet every time I see something like this, it comes from somebody who posts all this feminist stuff online. So
well, was one of those groundbreaking women Margaret Thatcher? I'm just wondering.
Actually, no. Don't know.
Well, I can't imagine why.
Oh, no.
I hope they
oh,
celebrated
gosh.
Golda Meir for starting that amazing war.
They didn't even celebrate the woman whose family together as a group started the first hospital in the United States for children under the age of 6 who were severely or profoundly handicapped. They didn't celebrate women who did things that were not done before, even if it was a different way of doing a thing that was being done. They celebrate, like one of the pictures was a woman showing a photograph of her son to war veterans that were coming back, or POWs that were coming back from war, because she was looking for him. She was trying to find him. And it is a historical moment in that it was the end of a war. There were POWs coming home. She was involved in it, but it doesn't make her remarkable. It's a woman being involved in a situation in which men were remarkable.
Mm-hmm. The funny thing about this is how they like to sweep under the rug that most of these people, most of these women that actually, you know, did things historically, a good portion of them did it all without feminism.
Yeah,
well, that's why Margaret Thatcher.
Thank you.
You know, she said, I don't owe the sisterhood anything, and she said feminism was poison, right? And so, therefore, you know, no cookies for you, Margaret Thatcher, despite your massive accomplishments that you did all on your own as a woman, essentially. You know, I mean, like she was one tough bird, and whether you liked her politics or not. And yet her accomplishment is meaningless because she did not get down on her hands and knees and lick the feet of feminism and say, thank you for giving me the opportunity to do something with my life besides getting, you know, beaten and making sandwiches, right? Like, you know. Thank you, feminism, for giving me the right to speak, which was a right that women had before feminism, right?
Like, no, the reality anyway. Is that what's the messed up part is, you know, the movement's like, if it weren't for us women, you'd be nothing. When the reality is, no, if it weren't for women, feminism would be nothing.
Yeah, okay. They really can't take credit for anything. Mm-hmm. Even the biggest feather in feminism's hat, even suffrage, the biggest feather in feminism's hat. Is not truly a female accomplishment. There is not a group that was disenfranchised during the 19th and 20th centuries that did not suffer the same thing women did when it came to voting rights. But feminism, the suffragette movement, the suffragist movement, for the most part, focused on women. You know, there were men right. in the United States who did not get the right to vote until after a man walked on the moon. But
exactly.
women got the right to vote. White but, privileged but, women got the exactly. right to vote.
Right. It was the 20s. Yeah, rich white women did. Not poverty-stricken white women. They didn't count either.
Nope.
It was black women were not allowed. They used black women and the poverty-stricken white women to make their numbers count. And once their numbers counted, they changed the ability to vote. There's two separate groups of suffragettes that were warring each other, but they joined in together because they didn't want black women to have the vote. They didn't even care about black men. I mean, they didn't even exist to them. And they didn't want – they only wanted a certain class of people, and they didn't want black women or poverty-stricken white women. And there were lots of members of the suffragette movement who were actually a part of the women's KKK as well. So when they try and tell me that me, as a black and Puerto Rican woman, I owe my human rights to the suffragettes, I'm like, oh, okay. Right. So you want me to go thank the KKK for my human rights, not the Civil Rights Act? Okay, right. I'll get right on that.
Yeah.
I was talking to a feminist there recently, an Irish feminist of all things. She was saying to me that it was thanks to feminists that Irish women got the vote. Irish women and Irish men got the vote at the exact same time back in 1918. One of our first cabinet ministers was a woman, Countess Markovitch. I mean, it's a constant con. They want you to everybody to believe that they have done so much. They've actually done. What have they actually done? What have they actually achieved? That question for, I think Rachel or Karen.
oh gosh, what have feminists actually achieved? Karen, I think you'd be better at this one.
You know, I honestly, feminists did achieve a fair bit. It's just that I don't really consider a whole lot of it to be a fair bit. It you know, so many of their achievements came at the expense of an injustice toward another group, right? Like there always seems to be a fundamental injustice lying underneath every single one. One of the biggest ones that I tend to talk about is the early activism prior to women getting the vote. The early women's lobby changing marital property rights for women, and this seemed to be mostly. This seemed to spread across the Western world, and so state by state in the United States, it would have happened in a different year. But it was just sort of a wave, just like the Tender Years Doctrine was a wave across the Western world. But what those property rights in marriage that did not give women equality in marriage. It did not place men and women in an equal conservatorship of finances and property within marriage. What it did was it emancipated women's property from the institution of marriage itself. And this is why any feminist who tells you women weren't allowed to own property is lying through her teeth. Women were always allowed to own property as long as they were unmarried. When they got married, they became femme covert as opposed to femme sole. And this activism, depending on where you are, anywhere between the 1850s and the 1920s, caused women to become considered femme sole yet again, as if they were single, even after they were married, which meant that it basically was a what's mine is mine and what's yours is ours. It did nothing to relieve the husband or absolve the husband of 100% responsibility for the daily necessaries of his wife, feeding, sheltering, clothing, and not just feeding, sheltering, and clothing her, but doing so up to his standard of living and what he could provide for her realistically. So if he dressed himself in silk and he dressed her in sackcloth, he could actually be charged with the crime of abandonment. Even if she was wealthier than him. And this is what led to
this wonderful innovation of UK suffragettes back in the 1910s of refusing to pay their income taxes, saying, you know, no vote, no tax. But their husbands being the ones going to jail for tax evasion because the man was responsible for all of her necessities, including the taxes owing on her income and her property. And so basically you had a situation where a woman was, she had all of her earnings and all of her property was hers, and her husband had no right or claim to it. Her children had no right or claim to it, but she had a claim to be supported by him. She had a claim to have him support her children and to never have to spend a penny of her own money on it. And even if she did support the family, if her husband was unemployed, if she supported the family, she could sue her husband for reimbursement, even for her own expenses. I mean, it was just insane. That was a major accomplishment. And one of the most hilarious things is then you had in the 1950s and 60s and early 70s, feminists saying it's really unfair that women need a male cosigner to take out a mortgage or a loan, right? There was no law saying women had to have a male cosigner. There was just no law against requiring it. And the reason it was required was because she couldn't be held accountable for her debts legally. If she defaulted, the only person that they could legally recover that money from was her husband or her father. Right? And this was considered unfair to feminists. It's just the entire thing, like everything that they have done has been to get women as many rights as possible and maintain male responsibility to the utmost degree as possible, you know, as much as they can.
Okay. To answer the question, I mean, your whole entire presentation at the men's conference just brilliantly lays out the whole history. So if anyone's interested in what Karen had to say, please Google her online video of her presentation at the International Men's Conference, and she just goes through the history of feminism beautifully. This kind of ties in, but going back to the original question, what has feminism accomplished? I'm going to point to what I think is the greatest, absolutely most profound triumph of feminism, which was Roe versus Wade, the right to choose parenthood for women, which was established 1973 in the United States. The Supreme Court agreed that, yes, women have the right to decide if they're going to be parents. Less than 10 years later, Karen DeCrow is arguing a case, I don't know if it was in the Supreme Court, but it's the Frank Serpico case, where her argument, I have it right in front of me, and it's just so beautiful. It's only a few sentences. I'd like to read it to you. Her argument is this: the courts have properly determined that a man should neither be able to force a woman to have an abortion nor to prevent her from having one, should she so choose. Justice therefore dictates that if a woman makes a unilateral decision to bring pregnancy to term and the biological father does not and cannot share in this decision, he should not be liable for 21 years of support. Or, put another way, autonomous women making independent decisions about their lives should not expect men to finance their choice. Karen DeCrow won and lost on appeal. National Organization of Women, and which is the largest feminist organization in the United States, and several other feminist activists immediately poured money into denying men the exact same reproductive freedom that they achieved. So I'd say the biggest, most life-changing thing for women is that we get to choose parenthood. The fight now is to make sure that all the humans get to choose parenthood. And it comes right back to what Karen was saying, that feminists want men to finance their choices. Well, are you a grown-up or are you not? Are you an adult or are you not? Are you equal or are you not? This is where the rubber hits the road.
Are you autonomous or are you not?
Yeah, it's even more extreme than that, because I went through in a discussion one time and looked at the vast variety of birth control options women have. We don't have to get pregnant. There is no such thing as accidental pregnancy. There's pregnancy that happens because we were careless, but there is not accidental pregnancy. And accidents, when you run into something that you just didn't know was there, you know, something that you're going through a room that you left clean and somebody left something and sitting and you trip over it and fall, that's an accident. If you leave a roller skate on the stairway and then you step on the roller skate and fall down the stairs, that's a mistake.
Well, I could trip and fall on a penis.
Well, you know, honestly,
you know, actually, I've been making that joke.
Let's not forget prohibition, guys.
Situation, let's you know, not. It's not like fell on his dick and you couldn't get back up, you know.
Oh, well, even if that's the case, even if that's the case, and it was actually an accident that you got pregnant, your birth control failed, or you were sexually assaulted, and, you know, you weren't planning on being sexually assaulted, so you just didn't really, you know, put your diaphragm in or whatever, right? Because you just didn't think to do it. There is maybe such a thing, there's an argument to be made that there's such a thing as an accidental pregnancy, but there is no such thing as an accidental birth. And there is really no such thing as accidental motherhood, because even after birth, the mother still has options to absolve herself of responsibility to that child, right?
Yeah. And some of those options exist because of a brutality committed by women and girls. Safe haven abandonment centers exist because women put their babies in dumpsters and trash cans and public toilets to dispose of them like garbage. This is something that,
this is disgusting.
We have an epidemic of victim motherhood. Here's the thing. Exactly. You always have a choice. You know, so you made a choice. Okay, sometimes life doesn't look the way you planned it, or sometimes crap happens and it doesn't turn out the way exactly you wanted it to happen. But you do have a choice to be a mother, and you own that choice because that is a life. This isn't, this isn't like a little piece of paper that you decided to take home with you. This is a life. This is a human being that is going to need you for the rest of their lives. You know, so you have that choice, and to say, oh, it was his fault because he's a man and therefore I am a victim of motherhood is repulsive to me.
It
angers me so deeply because, no, you made that choice. And to constantly blame the father, whether he ends up being there or not, you made that choice to be a parent. Now be a parent and stop playing this victim motherhood nonsense.
Yeah, you know what else? What terrible thing we have to thank feminism for? We have to thank feminism for treating motherhood one of the most wonderful experiences you can have. And yeah, it's challenging, and yeah, there are times when you just want to pull all the hair on your head out because it can be rough. But there is nothing that I've ever done in my life or that I ever will do in my life that is more rewarding to me than raising children and experiencing their responses to me, that they're amazing. And to take something like that and treat it like jail, or
slavery. Karen, but what do you think?
One of the most profound relationships you can
get.
You get that relationship, that's such a privilege and such a responsibility. And to treat it like something to
another thing feminists have done is they've managed to portray all of these choices that women have as if they're burdens, right? Like, why should it be only the woman's responsibility to use birth control? Well, because you're the only ones with the options that are actually reasonably effective, right? And so you have the freedom to choose between those these 20 different ways of preventing conception. And this guy has one, right? And it's not as effective as any of yours. Right,
and what did feminists do when they thought there was going to be another one?
Your immense freedom to choose is a burden. Oh, you know, having an abortion is a really hard, burdensome decision. Yeah, so what? At least you have that choice, right?
Exactly.
I've heard people argue having an IUD installed is quite painful, and therefore it's like a burden and an oppression. And I'm like, yeah, it's not painful compared to childbirth,
right? Yeah. Or compared to an abortion, I'm sure. So, how is having the options that men don't have oppression?
It is something else.
It's something else.
As oppression.
Well,
feminists treat birth control like a responsibility. When they're talking about men, they treat it like a responsibility that should be taken for granted as their responsibility. Wear a condom. Just do it. Wear a condom. Or get a vasectomy.
Or
whereas they treat it like a burdensome responsibility, a thing that's inflicted on women when women are being told to do it. We have birth control options that are barely noticeable when they happen. You know, like you put in a sponge, that's barely noticeable to you. You use the film, that's barely noticeable to you. You get the shot, that's no seconds once every few months. You take the pill, there's a few side effects, but it's when you use a condom, it reduces the physical sensation every time you use it. So women get upset about female genital mutilation because, among other things, because it reduces sexual pleasure. But it's an expectation that men will give up sexual pleasure to protect women from pregnancy by wearing a condom. Vasectomy, even though it's a simple surgery, it's still a surgery. It's still a medical procedure where the body is cut. So men do not have a non-invasive, non-burdensome, non-noticeable birth control option.
Well, and
yet,
try, as a man who's 20 years old to get a vasectomy.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
just
that's
try
the other
it.
Thing. Yeah, all over the United States, there are doctors that won't do a vasectomy without a man's significant other's permission.
Oh,
How many women would put up with that?
You have to be at least 30, and you have to already have children before the majority of doctors will do it. And this is the same for tubal ligation as well, at least in any place where healthcare is provided by the state. When I was 34 and my previous child was over 11 pounds and a month overdue, and I went into the doctor and I said, you know, I've had three kids, I'm in my mid-30s, I want a tubal. It took a lot of convincing to get even just the referral to talk to someone who could do that for me. And it's because they want to make sure that you're really sure that you aren't going to change your mind, that you aren't going to have it undone 2 years from now and then go and have another tubal ligation done at the state's expense, right? And with men and vasectomy, yes, a lot of doctors will require that if you're married, your significant other, your wife signs off on it. And they will not. I mean, my current boyfriend had his vasectomy when he was 18, and he went to 12 different doctors before he found one that just basically said, sure, I'll do it. You know, screw the guidelines, screw the potential malpractice suit, you know, screw all of this other stuff. Yeah, sure, I'll do it. It's not easy for a guy to even get a vasectomy. And yeah. At this point, because he's 31 now, having it reversed, he's looking at a 50% rate of having a sperm count if he gets his vasectomy reversed, and a 20% possibility of becoming a father. Right. So, I mean, and that just increases over time, the irreversibility of it. Right. So it's not something that, you know, if you want to have that permanently done, it's not even so much how invasive it is. It's how permanent it is, how much
Yep.
it can make it impossible for you to ever change your mind.
I was talking to a guy I know some time ago. He told me about a story he had heard from one of his friends. His friend wanted to have some more children with his wife, but his wife said she did not want any more children, so she made him go get a vasectomy. But she didn't make him. She gave him a choice, either get a vasectomy or I'm leaving you. So after he had the vasectomy, she left him, and she went out and had more kids with somebody else.
Oh,
I know.
Oh, that's terrible.
I believe the Apache Indians used to give their prisoners to their women to deal with.
Oh yeah, well, Islamic cultures too in the Dark Ages used to torture was considered women's work. So
I'm married. I know all about that.
Now yeah, we just call it
friend.
Probably
agree with you.
Oh gosh.
No, I just to get back to what
Judgy Bitch was saying, I'm very much pro-choice too regarding abortion. But that should be linked to reproductive rights for men. And Pauli Lam wrote a very good article in A Voice for Men, and what she stated that, you know, unmarried men should also have the right, connected with abortion rights for women, to renounce parenthood if they wish, or you know, or not, or the or you know, a woman who has a baby with a man needs to serve notice on the father that she's going to have this baby, his baby, and he has to give his explicit consent, and I think that's very perfectly fair.
See, you know, now, I would agree with that, except for I'm a little more extreme than Paul, right? And I would say that the default assumption, just like the default assumption for women is no, I don't want to become a parent. The default assumption for men should be no. And so it should not be tied with women's abortion rights. It should be just if you get pregnant, you do your best to convince him to accept some responsibility if he wishes to do that, right? And, you know, and that comes with rights that he is granted automatically when he accepts responsibility, right? And if you can't do that, well, you better do it quick, because if his default setting is no, and if you wait until after the child's here and then you go and try and convince him, no, his default setting is no. You cannot hold him accountable.
I agree. That's absolutely the way it should work, that if you get pregnant and decide to bring that child to term, whether you are married or not, I don't think marriage has anything to do with this at all. Just because you're married doesn't mean you've consented to have children.
Yeah.
If a woman's pregnant and she decides to bring that baby to term, it is her choice and her responsibility. Men get the exact same decision, whether or not they wish to be a parent, whether they wish to be responsible. The assumption is no. Your body.
What I mean is that in an abortion, like the woman have an abortion on kind of an abortion on request up to say 14 weeks or 24 weeks or whatever. So basically, the woman serves notice to the man. Look, do you want to look after this baby? Give 18 years of your commitment to it with your resources. And if the man says no, then she can go and get an abortion within the time limit. That's what I mean when I say connect.
You're talking about the restricted abortion rights. Okay, so the fact that a man is not going to support the baby would be the reason for the abortion. So that's kind of an Irish thing, right? We don't have those kind of restrictions.
Well, we have some in the United States. We have there are different states with different limits, but most states do not allow abortion during the third term except under certain medical conditions.
Right.
And there's a lot of reasons for that. I mean, when you're talking about the third term, you're not talking about something that is just tissue.
I would agree that we totally need restrictions on that sort of thing, you know, by then. That's a baby.
I mean,
there was an abominable
last
case
year. Dr. Gosnell.
Yeah, Kermit Gosnell. Oh my God.
My God. That was, and this is one of the reasons why I'm a pro-life person. I'm not a pro-legislation person as far as, you know, you can't go do that. Not because I think it's okay to kill just because they're not born yet, but because I don't think it would be an effective approach. But I'm very much against the exploitative end of the abortion industry.
Oh, you know what?
I make no mistake. I'm absolutely, but I do think that restrictions are, you know, I mean, by then you have more than enough time to know that you're pregnant. You know what I'm saying?
By the time a fetus is viable and can survive, I think it should be off the table unless there is some serious health concern.
Can I ask Janet Bloomfield a question? In America, can you get an abortion at 28 weeks?
I'm actually not American, and I don't know the answer to that. I know
depends
that
on where you are.
I am.
Yeah.
It depends on your state. It depends on your – well, it depends on a lot of things. There are states where it's legal, but areas within the state where it's not available because the industry is not there. Because
here in
it's
Canada.
Not supported by the local community attitude. Into some of the western states where the population is more sparse and you're in the Bible Belt, it may be legal to get an abortion at beyond 24 weeks, but not feasible to get an abortion beyond 24 weeks because nobody can maintain a business there doing it.
Well,
it's not profitable.
Here
and
in
that's
Canada,
a key thing about it.
Here in Canada, if you want a late-term abortion, you're flying to Ontario, wherever you are. But you can get them. And there was one case in Victoria. I was living in Victoria. It was reported on as a woman who lived in Victoria, BC. This was probably going on like 15, 20 years ago now, that she was suing the abortionist because her child, her fetus, survived the procedure. And she felt like that abortionist should be compensating her for the expenses of being a mother
her special needs
daughter who was 6 at the time, right, 6 years old, and, you know, because the abortion failed. Now, part of me is like, you know, if there is a situation in which having an abortion could result in the baby surviving, right? That maybe we need to rethink things. And one of the things that feminists do constantly is there were like 280 bills introduced in the U.S. to limit abortion rights. Yeah, and 260 of them referred to partial birth late-term abortions. So abortions in the third trimester, abortions after the fetus is viable, right? And
they were holding abortion clinics to the same medical standards of other practices which perform the same level of procedure.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, no.
That's
If you want to go get a nose job, the plastic surgeon does an interview to assess whether psychologically there might be some issues that you have that would make you regret having a nose job or unsatisfied with any nose job you get. Maybe it's just some kind of a body dysmorphic disorder that you have. You know, maybe you have other issues and your dissatisfaction with your nose could be addressed by them, right? That's required of plastic surgeons.
They
right?
even do that if it's not plastic surgery for physical appearance. I had a deformity inside my nose that was causing a blockage in my sinuses that was actually threatening to my eyesight eventually if it didn't get fixed. And they had to, you know, I had to assure my insurance company that I wasn't just having rhinoplasty because I didn't like my nose. You know, they do a lot to double check when you are having a surgery, and it is a minor surgery.
Oh yeah, no, they absolutely do. But frankly, if abortion isn't as quick, easy, and cheap as getting a haircut, feminists in the U.S. will be up in arms about it.
Oh yeah,
right. And this it's just absolutely. I mean, this is a major procedure. There should be guidelines and there should be a 24-hour waiting period like there is for any other surgery besides emergency
there
surgery.
Should be education.
Yes.
There's pro-life and there's pro-choice, and I think on one point that they can both work together on is getting the education on what abortion really is, because feminists talk about, oh, it's a woman's right to an abortion, blah, blah, but they don't talk about how can you minimize abortion. I'm pro-choice, but less abortions is always better.
Yes,
pro-abortion. You know, pro-choice doesn't mean yay abortion. No, it should mean, hey, let's try and focus on minimizing this, because it's a bit, you know, minimizing how many teen moms there are, how many abortions there are in general. And that's something that I think both pro-life and pro-choice can talk about. And my thought is, this is major education should be had with kids in school on this, not just how to put a condom on a banana, yeah, but the reality of how much does a child cost? Why is it more practical to have such and such set up before you have a child? And go into the gritty detail and show what an abortion is. Because I don't care if people are like, oh, no, we shouldn't show that to your child. Okay, would you rather there be a higher rate of your child having an abortion? Or would you rather your child see the gritty reality of what an abortion is? Okay, because
do you want your kid to go into something like that without knowing what it is at all?
Exactly.
Even if they are going to make that choice, they shouldn't go into it without.
Right, exactly. Even if that does happen, I'm not villainizing anybody. But if it does happen, you know, first of all, it'll minimize, and on top, it's not something that it's just, oh, it's just an abortion. Go have an abortion. It's all good. This is a really intense choice. Parenting, whether you choose not to parent or to parent, they're all very big decisions. There's not enough information, and kids need to know this younger because they're having sex. We can't pretend that, you know, teenagers aren't having sex as they are. So the more information that gets out there, you know, the more accountability, and stop playing this whole victim motherhood game. And then I'm just going to get pregnant, and who cares if I get an abortion, or who cares if I have a kid, because it's all his fault.
Yeah, I think the whole discussion is a really nice highlight of the fact that those of us who are sort of in the movement of being anti-feminist or who are interested in men's rights, we aren't all on the same political page, and we don't have to be. It's not required, right? Whether you're pro-life or pro-choice or somewhere in between, we can talk about these issues without getting absolutely blinded by any ideology, whether that's political or social ideology like feminism. And that's part of what's so great about things like the men's conference and this conversation, and that you won't find in a feminist discussion, right? It devolves right into hysterics, and eventually someone's going to bring up rape culture.
So, Ruth, you want to say something there?
Yes, indeed. I've been listening here to the discussion regarding abortion and pregnancy at the moment. I certainly believe that in our schools we need to be looking at educating both our boys and our girls in relation to the prevention of pregnancy. It is something that I know within my own area that I represent, we have had a number of projects in relation to young people, both boys and girls, taking home these handmade babies and having to get up during the night when they're crying and having to take them for walks and having to feed them and change them and all of that there. And it is a real learning curve for our young people. I don't think they realise the amount of work and the amount of parenting that is actually involved with such a young baby. But abortion is something my political party would be very much against abortion. I may or may not have a different view on that, but I certainly do think that if both boys and girls were shown the effects of the aftermath of an abortion, I think they would be extremely shocked. I was on Facebook the other day and someone had put, some obviously a nurse who was in the operating room, had filmed this beautiful, beautiful, perfectly formed little baby, totally enclosed in its placenta. The little baby was still moving. Its little arms were moving. And that child literally died on screen. It was so moving, so upsetting, and so heartbreaking to watch. And I think that, you know, rather than our young people talking about abortion, I think we need to educate them in pregnancy prevention. Get them at an early age, teach them from an early age, show them the pitfalls of having abortion, the impact it has on both boys' and girls' lives. It's not just a girl thing. And I think that is our way forward, preventing pregnancy is much better than carrying out abortion.
Absolutely.
Very much.
Yes.
Sorry, I'd like to go on. Sorry, I'd like to go on to. Am I echo here? I'm going to hang up, Anne. Can you? Can somebody add me again?
Can I just make one final parting comment regarding abortion? I think that if we connect men's reproductive rights and women's reproductive rights, then what will happen is in the long run, abortions will go down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because men and women will trust each other, mothers and fathers will trust each other more. That's why we need to overhaul family. So give men rights, and it's obvious that abortions will reduce over time.
Sorry, Paul, Ruth, can you mute your microphone, please?
Okay.
If you put your cursor up a bit, you'll see a red kind of phone symbol,
yes,
and then a cross, and then you have the next one over is your mute. Click on that.
Okay. That it?
Sorry. Good. No, almost.
We've still got a lot of echo.
Yeah. Or turn down your speakers, Ruth. Either turn down your speakers or click on the microphone icon.
That better?
Hello?
Hello?
Yes.
Yes.
No. Yeah. Yeah. You have to turn off the mic.
Yeah. If we can hear Ruth, she's not muted.
Yeah.
Sorry, quickly, we're half an hour away till the end here. I'd like to move on to rape culture. Is it real? Is it a bogus myth caused by feminism? One of the things I'd like to talk about is, basically, I was talking to somebody about this issue, and I said, if a man's on top of a woman and they're having sex, she says, I've had enough, thanks very much, get off me, and he keeps on going. That is rape to me. But if a woman is on top of a man, and he said, that's not thanks very much, get off me, and she keeps going. In most countries, that's not rape.
Well,
that's true, it's not.
That's because he's a man. And so, you know, a woman can't rape a man with her vagina, according to a lot of people, including the law in many countries, and including probably one of the most infamous feminists regarding the entire concept of rape culture. Mary P. Koss, who consulted with the CDC, Centers for Disease Control, on their definitions in their National Intimate Partner and Sexual Violence Survey, she described men's experiences of having had unwanted sex with their female partners as legitimate, but more to do with their ambivalence about their own desires than actual rape or actual victimization. In other words, she sort of explained and hand-waved away her choosing to define rape as something that a woman cannot do to a man using heterosexual sex. She hand-waved it away by saying, essentially, well, the men really wanted it. They just didn't know at the time that they wanted it.
You were asking, what was he wearing?
Yeah, I think he was not even wearing underwear.
He was probably wearing socks.
Probably
ambivalent butt. And feminist research into sexual violence has been riding on Mary Koss's big butt ever since.
Oh God!
Last year, I did a Freedom of Information Act request for the raw data from the Center for Disease Control's National Intimate Partner and Sexual Violence Survey, because of their reporting. They reported in 2010. They reported for 2010 for the 12 months during 2010, the same number of men and boys having reported being forced to sexually penetrate as they did women and girls being forced to be sexually penetrated. But they didn't call it rape when it happened to men and boys. And there's been a lot of debate among social justice warriors and men's rights activists and anti-feminists and various groups, really, about what that means. So I was looking for basically how many men reported that? How many heterosexual men and boys reported that? And how many of them reported female perpetrators? And not only did the researchers find a way to get out of fully fulfilling the Freedom of Information Act request, because they only gave me partial information, but when I asked for an explanation as to why the definition was different, the researcher could not answer me. There's a video that Allison and I made, Allison Tiemann and I made from this. She did this brilliant thing with puzzle pieces that just makes it really clear how stupid it is to say it's different, how ridiculous and bigoted it is to say it's different. And then at the end, she plays that part of that phone call. And this woman just stammered and stumbled and essentially said something along as, well, that's what the experts said. Well, it's always been that way. Well, it's just how it is. This is the first time we've even asked this kind of questions, none of which was really true. Those questions have been asked before, and it hasn't always been that way. But they weren't prepared for it at all.
Well,
they just could not handle the question.
One of the justifications Koss gave in the later pages of that report, the full report, was that the reason why they differentiated made to penetrate from rape was because there was some question regarding whether perhaps men who had been made to penetrate by women had been accidentally captured in the rape statistics done in other surveys and studies, right? So they were like, oh my goodness, some of these other studies are wording things like, have you ever been forced to have sexual intercourse, right? And they're capturing male victims of female perpetrators, and we don't want that, so we're going to separate it out so that we don't capture those under this particular type of crime anymore, right? So it was specifically done to avoid capturing male victims of female perpetrators of forced sexual intercourse in the numbers under the definition, the name that everybody recognizes as forced sexual intercourse.
All of this discussion is about actual rape. My understanding of rape culture is that it's like the surrounding culture that supports and encourages rape. So it's like when I order a peach smoothie and there's a banana in it and I'm not aware of that, that's like stuffing phallic things in my mouth without my knowledge and consent, and that supports the whole
rape. Now I'm hungry.
All that stuff is plays into that hysteria. I mean, they're saying that they expanded the definition of rape, and they keep doing that. Of course, if you continue to expand what qualifies as rape to things that don't really qualify or count as forced sex,
like bananas course, in a smoothie.
Of course, it's going to seem like there is an epidemic of rape, that there's a rape culture. You keep redefining what rape means to fit your definition. Of course it's going to seem like that.
Well, there's two things going on here with feminism and rape culture. The first thing, and it's the primary thing, is that feminists are trying as hard as they can to take the definition of rape away from what it actually is, away from the perpetrator deliberately, knowingly, and willfully contravening the victim's right or ability to refuse. That's rape. When you contravene the other person's ability or right to refuse, you refuse to recognize their bodily autonomy. That's rape. But they're trying to take it as far away from that as possible to give the possibility of the greatest number of accusations possible. But the other half of it is they're trying to get the term rape culture to become the definition of disagreeing with feminist promulgation on sex in any way, shape, or form.
Just one other thing, basically, for some of you who don't actually know, incidence of rape and all violent crimes by men is actually on the way down. Some of the theory behind that is that because of the reduction of lead in our atmosphere from paints, from fuel, fossil fuel, the result of that is that the actual rape incidences actually is a fifth of what it was 40, 50 years ago.
Well, okay, yeah, I could actually see that being a, you know, one of the causes for violent crime in general to go down. I mean, if lead poisoning decreases the inhibitive center of your brain, the part of your brain that the part of my brain that makes me not swear around my mom and be able to manage it, even though I have the saltiest tongue on the face of the planet, just because, hey, I'm able to inhibit my initial impulses, then yeah, there's also a lot of sort of when you look at what feminists were proposing in the 70s and the 80s as far as pornography. And Andrea Dworkin and Catherine MacKinnon in particular, basically making the claim that pornography trains men to rape. But then you look at the incidence of rape falling over 80% since the introduction of the VCR. So basically the moment porn became available to somebody who didn't want to go to the XXX theater and sit in a dark room with a bunch of strangers to watch porn, they could watch it in their own home, right? And since the advent of the internet and the internet is for porn thing, it's only continued to decrease, right? But what I find amazing is that you can have somebody positing a causal relationship, porn trains men to rape, despite having an inverse correlation that as porn increases, access to porn increases, rape goes down, right? And then on top of that, to have suddenly this huge kind of branch of the feminist movement claiming that we live in a rape culture, right? That rape is epidemic, that basically something that has decreased by 80% plus since the 1970s is now an epidemic. Right, this boggles my mind, and the fact that
you see because
go ahead.
Yeah, feminism is an ideology, is a government ideology, designed to paint men as victims. Paint men as victimizers and women as victims.
Yes.
To a target vulnerable men and women in society and tell them that there's something wrong with them and that they should be taking prescription drugs, or they should be altering their behavior in some way, or they should be giving money to them or something. The rape culture is basically it's part of the firewall of feminism to keep people, especially men, out of discussing family law issues, out of discussing the relationships between men and women, to keep men in their place outside, in the dreary world of politics, or doing the manual labor and providing the resources to the woman. It's about keeping men out by shaming men. That's why we got this rape culture, this
whole
fiction.
Well, you're all just a bunch of horrible rapey bastards, don't you know?
Yes.
Yeah. Well,
The reality with the rape culture is that, boy, for how long have boys have been raped by their teachers and they've been treating it like a rites of passage? There are boys who are raped, and then they have to pay child support to their rapists.
Right.
So the rape culture that is being portrayed is not really what's happening. If there is a rape culture, then it's regarding boys and men. So because when men said he's raped by a woman, it's still not even – there are people who still think that's not even possible. So they're completely false. And then another thing – that feminists, they love to, they grab onto rape and they use it as their shield. So they try and like push it and
bludgeon.
Right. And yeah. So the thing is, their attack on sex workers, they're telling women now that they're too stupid to know when they're raped. I'm an ex-sex worker. I did it for 13 years. Okay. To tell me that I was incapable of making my own choices with my body. And that I had no idea that I was being raped while I was having such a great time. Apparently, I'm just too much of an idiot. Now, their attack on sex workers goes into, we're for sex workers. What they really mean is we're for sex workers not being sex workers. They cannot conceive of women enjoying having sex to the point where they would like it to be a profession, because that can't be that's not possible. How could that possibly exist? So women, you know, they also confuse sex trafficking with women, with prostituting, which is not the same thing. So feminists like to tell everybody that they're the authority on rape, and if you think differently, well, then you're too stupid to know, and you're pretty much being raped, especially if you're a woman, because any form of sex with men and enjoyment, it must be rape, and if you don't know that, you're just an idiot.
Well, it's all about recontextualizing the price men pay, right? Because the whole slut-shaming thing too, right, which is part of rape culture according to feminists. This is a behavior that's predominantly done by women against other yes. women, right?
Yes.
And Roy Baumeister, who is a psychologist, he's a social psychologist, he posited that basically slut-shaming is pretty much the same as a union member yelling scab at somebody crossing the picket line. Right, that basically, in order to keep the price of sex that men are willing to pay, the price for it, which would be, you know, a $15,000 diamond and a lifelong commitment and you know, lifelong support and all of those things, right, to get access to sex, right, if there are women who are scabs who are giving it away for free, right, that hurts the sexual trade union of women. And I thought that was a really interesting kind of theory or hypothesis, right?
Right.
Yeah. But when you think about what's happening now is feminists cannot justify now that the sexual revolution has happened and women are free to make the choices to have sex with whoever they want and they don't have to remain chaste, and that's a good thing. And of course feminism claims to have helped bring this about, when in reality it was mostly the pill, right? But feminism wants to take credit for women's sexual freedom, but they still need to keep the price of sex artificially inflated. And so how do they do that? They don't make men pay the woman that they're having sex with for the sex by getting married and promising a lifelong commitment and all of that support and financial goodies and all of that. What they do is they put a fine on it, right? And there's no way for a man to know whether he's stepped across the line. And if feminists can just do that, right, to make it so that men have no idea whether having sex with this woman at this time is going to be a wonderful experience of casual sex or whether it's going to cost them their entire lives, right? Then they can keep everything in line. They can allow women to have all of the freedom and impose all of the restrictions on men.
That's why they're attacking due process rights so stridently. And that's something that I wanted to touch back on, that whole discussion about the incidence of rape going down and everything. I have a strong suspicion that some of that is accounted for by advancements in forensic science.
Yeah.
The incidence of rape is going down to an extent because we are better able to weed out women who are either accusing falsely entirely or accusing the wrong guy. And that includes women who don't want to admit who they were having sex with, so they're accusing some other guy of raping them when they get pregnant. You know, and that worked just fine when you couldn't find out who the father of the child was and when you couldn't find out whose DNA was on whose body, but it's not going to work so well when you have DNA testing. And I think that's making a difference there. But that is why feminists so stridently have attacked due process rights for men in sexual violence cases. They don't want men to be able to defend themselves when a woman makes that kind of an accusation.
Oh, and they want to increase the statute of limitations, too, or eliminate it altogether for sexual offenses.
Well, you know, there was actually a situation where they accidentally legalized prostitution for 6 years in the state of Rhode Island, and the rape rate dropped about 31%. Okay, that's pretty significant.
Oh, and so did the rate of STIs.
And in doing that, so when they sit there and say, well, you guys, the existence of sex workers and porn and all of these things, these are the things that are causing violence against women, this is... It's evidence of the contrary. It's completely the opposite. You offer consensual sex you know, to these men, and you do all these things, and it helps. It makes certain that the men who don't want Sorry. To have a relationship, but want to have sex with an adult, can do that, and it's readily accessible, and all these other things, and you know, it helps. So it's complete horseshit for these feminists to continue to preach this ideology that all of these things are having some kind of butterfly effect, that if you give it out for free, or if you have sex for money, that is somehow affecting all women negatively.
And you know, that brings up another thought here. And you know, the idea of increased sexual freedom among women, reducing rape, it's not just rape that it's reducing, it's going to reduce accusations of rape, because one of the factors, and I can't remember the name of the study, and it's a widely known study, where they talked to women who did falsely accuse, who were confirmed to falsely accuse, and they found out why they were falsely accusing, and some of them did that to cover up for themselves because they didn't feel permitted to engage in the sexual behaviors they were engaging in. So when they were, you know, caught one way or another, then they cried rape. That goes right. down when right. when we stop shaming women for sex, when we stop allowing women to shame other women for being right. sexually free.
Exactly. And also the feminists, what they're doing is they're hurting sex workers, because with their campaigns, I mean, I've spoken about this before, in Myanmar, the feminists have pushed against sex workers, but what's happened is the women were raided, their children were taken away, the police who raided the brothels were corrupt and raped them. Then in another country, the women were put in quote-unquote rehabilitation camps, where there was little to no medical attention, they were raped and beaten again. All because why? Because these women are too stupid to make their own choices? Yeah, that sure sounds like women's rights to me. And yes, exactly. The more that women are sexually comfortable and feel sexual and do their own sexual authentic take their own authentic sexual choices and own their choices sexually, we will have a lot healthier sexual community.
And I'd like to move back to 16.
I mean, there's a service. Can I just say one thing, John?
Go on.
There's a service. I mean, the feminists are so heartless, because when you think about this, there's a service in the UK called TLC Trust, which provides a very humane service matching disabled people with sex workers so they can have some sexual release. I mean, that's like awesome. A humane, compassionate service. And these heartless feminists would like to shut that down. It just shows you just how heartless these people are.
I mean, it comes into back because people often call women the gatekeepers of sexuality. Well, what do you do when the gatekeepers don't want to ever open the gate? What are you supposed to do? People are just supposed to starve at the gate? No, come on. There are other options. And the feminists like to poke at sex workers, but the reality is there would not be the amount of sex workers if there were more sexually healthy women. That is a fact.
Yeah, I would agree. There, I've talked to any number of young women, you know, anywhere from 18 to 25, who have said to me that they're concerned with the sort of the feminist mantra that any amount of alcohol invalidates consent because, hey, I can't even get to the point where I would have hook up with a guy, right, even if I really liked him, unless I've had a few drinks, right? And I'm thinking to myself, you know, that's a really sad state of affairs that, you know, and honestly, I'm not sure whether it's, you know, whether it's the culture that's telling them or whether it's feminism that's telling them or whether it's their own biology that's telling them that they need to be inhibited about sex.
Maybe a
combination of all of those things. But, you know, like, basically, if you have young women of college age feeling like they need to have a few drinks or smoke a joint before they're even capable of becoming disinhibited enough to say yes to sex, right? And then you have the other side of the coin, which is feminists saying any amount of intoxication negates consent, vitiates consent. Then you've just completely described, you know, a huge percentage of young women as rape victims every time they hook up, whether they consented or not.
Right, and the thing is, feminism also
sorry,
that pushes.
Sorry, Kristal, we have to round up very shortly. I want to move back to the 16th century to the author and playwright William Shakespeare. He wrote two particular plays. One was Macbeth, and the other one was Coriolanus. In both of those plays, the lead character listens to both his mother and his wife. Do any of you think that men listen to women, or do we treat women like absolute muck? Is that what any of you get?
No, if men didn't listen to women, the Violence Against Women Act in the United States never would have passed.
Yeah. Oh, no, it's absolutely men. Men listen to women. Susan B. Anthony in 1849 stated that it's conceded by everyone that our sex, women, basically create the moral and social values of our society, right? You look at election posters, campaign posters from prior to women's suffrage, and they'll say, you know, tell your man to vote for this guy, right? I mean, like, men have always, you have Obama saying, well, you know, I don't make any decision till I run it past Michelle first, right? I mean, you have this situation where women have always had this huge amount of soft power, right? And by soft power, I don't mean not effective. I mean imbued with plausible deniability, right? Oh, sure, I was just the person who whispered in his ear, right? I'm not the one who actually went out and did it. Lady Macbeth was just the person who said, I'd kill my own child if you wanted me to do it, and you're not going to do this because I want you to do it, right? And then he goes and does it, and the only thing I think Shakespeare got wrong in that entire scenario was, I don't think Lady Macbeth, if she was a typical feminist woman, she would not have killed herself. She would have just attached herself to King Duncan, become his mistress, and continued wielding her soft power from the safety of that little situation too, right? I mean, this is how women have always wielded power, and then you give them on top of that, you give them overt political power and economic power and all of these things, right? Men are still listening to them. That's the problem. Right? Do women want to be considered equal, or do they want to be considered the voice who whispers in the ear and then is nowhere to be found when it's time for the buck to stop, right? For somebody to be held accountable.
Crema worm tongue.
Sorry, yeah. just moving on a bit more. We are having a show next week. The show is going to be on women's studies. If any of you want to come back onto it again, we have the man who wrote our article on our website on the same subject. If you check out the website, menshumanrightsireland.org, we have a article there about women's studies on that. We have articles about rape culture. We have articles about the Istanbul Convention, which we did not get into here tonight because it's a European thing. It's very like the Violence Against Women Act in the USA. But next week, we're going to have David, who helped write the article itself. And I think Paul's going to be co-host on that one as well. So if any of you want to come back onto it, please do.
Well, I only got 63 in women's.
Yeah, definitely.
Yes.
I'll be there.
Close up.
I think Ruth wanted to come in.
Ruth, please speak.
Ruth?
Hello.
How are you doing?
Hello. Yes, no, I was just thinking about the last topic that they were speaking about regarding men listening to women. I have always found that men do certainly listen to women. And sitting on Belfast City Council, which is dominated by men, I know that men take women's points of view, particularly in the chamber on board. And I know that whenever I was speaking, putting the motion forward regarding International Men's Day, you could quite clearly see not only the unexpectedness and the surprise on their faces whenever I began to speak regarding men's rights, but the nodding of heads in agreement, which I find very pleasing, so I did. And I know that the next day, whenever I walked into City Hall, I certainly got a pat on the back from one or two gentlemen who said, "Well done, Ruth, we're so glad you brought that up."
Well done. But,
you know, and it's wonderful. I think it's all how women nurture their children as to the way that child grows up and the respect that it has for its fellow human being, whether that human being be male or female. And mothers play a huge role in that, and men know that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And it's not just men who listen to women, it's the whole culture, which is precisely why this panel is composed of all women talking about men.
Exactly, because there have been men who have been saying what we're saying for decades.
Decades?
Yeah. But now when women come forward, people start to listen. So that definitely shows where our society is regarding listening to what men have to say. Because men have been saying, this is what we need. And people have not been listening. But when women come forward and say it, then people start to listen. So that's a really big reflection on where we are in our society.
You know, I actually think it's not just that people listen. Because every single man that I have mentioned what I do to at work, right, you know, "Oh, well, what do you do on YouTube?" "Well, I'm an anti-feminist, and here's one of the reasons why." And then they get this kind of, you know, sort of pensive look on their face. In one case, my boss, I told him about it, and he kind of went, "Huh," and walked away. And about 5 minutes later, he comes up to me and says, "Did you know that if I moved in with a woman who had children, after 6 months, she could come after me for child support for those children that aren't even mine?" And I'm like, yeah, I know. It's almost like the fact that a woman brings up the subject gives men the feeling that they have permission to say what they were already thinking, right? Mm-hmm. That they, you know, where they would have just kept their mouth shut before, now they feel free to talk. And I come across this at work. I come across this with guys in the lineup at the grocery store, people sitting next to me on the airplane, you know, customers in at the restaurant where I work, you know, all of these men who, the moment that you say it, they kind of get this, huh? And then all of a sudden things come out that they've experienced and that they've, you know, that have happened to them or that they know somebody that has happened to, and they feel like all of a sudden it's safe and they have permission to talk about it, right? And that's why I think that women doing what we do is so incredibly important, because men will, so many of them, men have been talking about this for a long time and not they don't get listened to. But in addition, so many men they stay silent until a woman actually comes in and opens the subject and says,
right,
you know what,
they haven't
it's okay.
Felt safe to. They live in a society where it hasn't been safe for them to speak. So it's, you know, women have been the ones who are saying, this is what we're going to talk about. So it hasn't really been safe for men to speak. They've been, you know, some men have lost their jobs and stuff like that if they don't fit what feminism says they should do. So it's been pretty dangerous for men to even come forward and say, this is what I need.
Yeah.
We're rounding up very shortly. Is there anything you have planned for the future? Janet, you haven't spoken in a while.
Well, we're just in the early organizing stages of the second international conference on men's issues. We're not sure of a location quite yet, but that is going to be happening. And I'd say if anyone listening is just new to these ideas and wants to find out more, your first stop should be Men's Human Rights Ireland, all one word, .org, or you can check avoiceformen.com. There's a lot of answers to questions. It is safe to ask. There are people listening, and we do care.
Yeah. All right, folks, we are coming to the last 40 seconds. Last word, Janet. I'm actually going to have the last word because I am one of the people behind Men's Human Rights Ireland. My name is John Gormley. This has been a fantastic experience. I want to thank all the ladies here for coming in tonight and Paul Carr, my co-host. Women Against Feminism is a fantastic thing to have happened in the last few months. Thank you, ladies.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Yeah,
good night.
Definitely.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are we still on air?
Thank you.
Yep.